President of the Cooperative Republic of Guyana, His Excellency Dr. Mohamed Irfan Ali, Minister of Education, Honorable Priyamanik Chan, Minister of Natural Resources, Honorable Vikram Bharat, Regional Chairman, Mr. Brian Alicock, Regional Executive Officer, Mr. Kar Singh, other government officials, members of the media, ladies and gentlemen, good morning. It is with great honor and privilege that we, the people of NAPI, which include the satellite communities of Hiawa and Parishara, extend our warmest welcome to His Excellency and team, the esteemed leader whose dedication and vision have guided our nation to new heights. As we gather here today, we are profoundly grateful for the opportunity to host His Excellency among us, a promise He has kept. His Excellency embodies the values of leadership, compassion, and progress. He has been instrumental in steering our country through challenges and triumphs, always with an unwavering commitment to the better of our society. Today, Mr. President, your presence graces us with inspiration and optimism. You serve as a beacon of hope, reminding us of our collective potential and the importance of unity in achieving our shared goals. Your visit fills us with pride and reaffirms our dedication to a brighter future under your esteemed leadership. Once again, welcome and thank you.
Thank you, Tushal, for your official welcome, of course, to our visiting team and to all the villagers here at NAPI Village. Without further ado, I would like to invite to the microphone, I will hand the microphone over, that is, to our esteemed regional chairman, Mr. Brian Alicock, to offer his remarks.
Thank you very much, Master of Ceremony. Good morning, one and all. Oh, yeah, so and so. Yeah, I suppose be happy. His Excellency. Yeah. This is the day that the Lord has made. You will sing. Yeah. No, no, when you come.
Let's start to the right foot. This is the day that the Lord has made.
This is the day that the Lord hath made, that the Lord hath made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. This is the day that the Lord hath made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. This is the day that the Lord has made. Thank you. Please sit down. His Excellency Dr. Mohamed Irfan Ali, President of the Cooperative Republic of Guyana, Honorable Minister Priyamanik Chan, Minister of Education, and Honorable Minister Vikram Bharat, Minister of Natural Resources, all honorable people are here with us this morning. Tushal, Aryo, we have a whole list here. The Consul General is with us. Representative of the Prime Minister here. We have the PS for Amerindian Affairs, is somewhere wrong. Okay. And other members of staff from the Office of the President, from the various ministries And I know that, you know, you have a large number of contingent here that came to visit you. And let me tell you, and let me remind you, you see those that are sitting here? They're all like me. We have young people leading our country. Put your hands together for His Excellency and team. And I could tell you, there is no other government could do and assist you in the time of need like our government is doing today. Right? Nobody else. And we just don't talk, we deliver on our commitments. I don't like to use the word promise because you could promise a lot of things and never fulfill it. But when we commit to the people's need. And I was telling the other leaders yesterday that when we are looking at what is developing in our region, we are the fastest developing region in this country. You know, you look at it. And it's not, we didn't even finish the 5-year forest storm yet. And we have already completed but 99% of our manifesto delivered what we had committed to the people of this country. And I was telling the leaders in South Central, do not look at yourself alone. Your task is to look for your people's development. And people said the government is not helping them because why? They're selfish. Only them need or they want. They don't need. They don't want. Only them want to develop. But they forget our people. But we are not like them. We are a very inclusive government. We include everyone. And everyone benefiting from everything that is being done and being sent down to the villages. And of course, the president and the other ministers will elaborate further. But I'm saying I'm very proud of Region 9 because look at the kind of development that took place within the 3 years. And we are the fastest developing. You know, so let's put our hands together for our leader and the cabinet and the ministers of the government. Because we will not stop here. And I'll give you the assurance that we will not become another government. Everybody get serious, right? I'm telling you. I want when we going around for you to tell me which other government give you what you're getting now. You know? There's none. They come on Batak and everything else. But that's politics. We Batak each other, forget about. But let us look and remember in your time of need who came to your rescue. And you'll get more things today when the president finishes his presentation. Right? So, you know, let us look at that. I look at some postings on Facebook. We get blackout for 12 hours in Latin. And some of our own comrades say, I hope we don't get blackout 2025 November, because then we'll get a vote. Look how, you know, narrow-minded these people are. You're looking at the big picture, you're looking at the little things. One day blackout and you say you're going to vote. Do not think like that. Think for the future, our children. And you hear everything else from the minister and president and Minister Vikram. Because what we are experiencing and enjoying here, it is done by our government. Yesterday I reminded the people, I said, today I was driving through coming and my driver said, we ain't got too much smoke today. I said, because the sun ain't come up yet. But I reminded the leaders, you got to be proactive. Tell your people not to light fires. Some people go and catch fish, hunt, and the light of fire and left it. The mountain today is like you have fossil fuel between your rocks. So when they light up, it goes on. In the Philippines, I see them digging out those things. I know some people went to help out the fire there. We had a closure for 2 days at the hydro because of the smoke. They couldn't breathe. They couldn't work. You know? So let us remember, people still light the fire. They pass in, they light the grass. They just love to light fires. You know? But you're destroying it. And I used to tell people in the north when I would see you, you know, when we had a program called Eye on the Environment on Radio Pyrama. Every day we used to broadcast against the fire. And I tell them at public meetings, I say, look, imagine you got your baby, you wrap it up in towel or whatever and put it in the grass and light the fire. That is what you're doing to all the rest of animals. My driver just came back from Georgetown to be on the service with me. He said, they're the first thing they see, jaguar, deer, powys, akuri, you know, crossing the road. I said, because they're looking for shelter from the fire. I see them knock down a tire on the road. Why hit the thing, the drivers, you know? Drivers, why knock down an animal? What animal do you? So be careful, the drivers, the driving on the road is better now. They might come and tell me they got a highway to Napi. Right? So the flying and the motorcycles. Let me remind you, I was talking with the commander. Most of the accident and causing death is motorcycle riders without helmet. So I just want to alert you, this is the season when everybody's sporting, drinking, smoking. Be careful. All of us want to see the future development within our region, within our communities. You know, and I was talking with the Toshaw earlier with the GDOI reps. We know the situation of the water drying up in these hand dug wells. So the alternative at the moment, you'll have to sink it a little more so that the water could keep coming. So look at it, and I hear Tisha was requesting some help from GWI, right? So, but look at what you need to develop. Now what you want is your needs. And needs for yourselves, for your children's future. And you'll hear good news just now from the Minister of Education of what's happening with education and the President of Health and so. Right, so once again, I must thank you for coming out to this meeting this morning. I know everybody talking about Holy Saturday and these things. Right, be absorbed that. Nevertheless, I must thank each and every one of you for being here. And of course, we have the media with us. We have the security with us, right? So all of us are involved in this development of our communities, our region, and more so our nation. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Regional Chairman of Region 9, Mr. Brian Alicock, for your brief remarks. I trust that the chairman has enlightened you and has awakened your spirits and has put you in the, set the pace for our ministers to come now, right? Everyone all right, ready? Wonderful. Please welcome to stage, to the microphone at this point, at this moment, the Honorable Minister of Natural Resources, the Honorable Vikram Bharat. Put your hands together, ladies and gentlemen.
Thank you. Brothers and sisters, good morning. Today is indeed a good day. A good day for the North Rupununi. I say that because we have no other than our president visiting you Central, Central and North. I say that because we have no other than our president visiting these communities. President has been in the region since yesterday. We've been to Deep South and South Central, and now we are here in Central. It just shows the commitment by His Excellency and our government to our people. It is yet another promise being fulfilled by His Excellency and His government. Because when we campaign in the 2020 election campaign, we promise that once we get back into government, we will keep coming to your communities. And I can tell you that this is the third consecutive year that the president is visiting on an Easter weekend, visiting this region, region number 9. And that, my friends, is commitment. That is genuine commitment to show that the president and your government care about your well-being and the development of your communities and your region. And we have been seeing massive development taking place across our entire country. And that is yet another promise that we made, that we are going to ensure that every single Guyanese benefit from the government program and policies, that every single community benefit, and that every single region is developed so that we can say we have a better Guyana 5-6 years from today. Today, we can boast that we have better healthcare, better education system, better infrastructure, better education. But most importantly, I believe the greatest achievement of our government, the People's Progressive Party civic government since 1992, to date, is that we brought back hope to our people and our country. Because I'm sure the senior folks here would recall that it was a time when Guyanese lost hope. You lost hope in your own country and the government back then. That is why today we say that there are so many Guyanese outside of Guyana, more than living in Guyana. And it is true. And when we look back at the reason why there are so many Guyanese outside of Guyana than in Guyana, it is because of the post-independence period, 1966 to 1992, when people lost hope due to rigged elections, poor infrastructure, dictatorship. Our people were running to Venezuela, to Brazil, to Suriname, on the coastland, many Barbadians from where I came from. They went to the US, they went to Canada, and they did everything possible to leave our country. So I consider that as the greatest achievement of our government from 1992 to 2015, and then the continuation of that success story from 2020 to today, is that we brought back hope to every single Guyanese, whether you live in the hinterland or the coastland. And we've been working very hard, His Excellency and His Cabinet has been working very hard to ensure that we bridge the gap between the hinterland and the coastland. And today we see that gap is narrowing. We see it is much narrower than it used to be in the past. Today we can have healthcare facility right here in Region 9 that is being offered on the coast. Today our children can study and earn a diploma or degree right in your own village with Wi-Fi coming from your own community. That is the kind of achievement that we have achieved over the short 3.5 years since our president took over. And I want to say that since President Ali took over government in August 2020, he has taken us through two of the most difficult situations this country has ever faced in our history. And one is the COVID period. We took over during the height of COVID, and the way in which His Excellency managed the economy and the situation, we were used as a model country around the world. Today, as Guyanese, we can boast that we have the fastest growing economy in the world, while many other countries are struggling because of the impact of COVID and the war in Ukraine and Palestine and elsewhere. Today, we sit comfortable as one of the fastest growing economy, or the fastest growing economy in the world. And many people may want to say that it's because of oil and gas. But we need to say to them that Guyana is the second fastest economy without oil and gas, or the second fastest growing non-oil economy in the world. So it is not only because of oil and gas. It is because of the management of the economy by His Excellency, the President of Guyana, or Vice President, and the Cabinet, assisted by the technical staff. And that is what you voted for. That is why you entrusted us to be in government, to ensure that we manage the affairs so that every single Guyanese can benefit from our program and policies. Today, and in 2024, we have one of the largest budgets ever in the history of our country. One of the largest budgets in the history of our country. Many people are spreading misinformation that we are using oil money, that we are spending out the oil money. But I want to say to you that it is only about 25% of that budget is coming from oil revenue. Most of the money that is making up that budget is coming from taxes. And I say that in a positive way. I say it in a positive way because we have not increased any taxes on our people. We have not introduced any new taxes on our people. As a matter of fact, we have reduced taxes by increasing the threshold for workers around the country to $100,000. But it's mainly because of the expansion of our economy. It is mainly because of the amount of investment that is coming into our country. And yes, oil and gas has brought a lot of investment to Guyana. But when investors come to Guyana, we don't speak of oil and gas only. The president, as a matter of fact, is a big advocate for agriculture and tourism, because he knows that agriculture and tourism is the lifeline of our country, especially the hinterland communities. And because of that, we have had many, many investors investing in these two sectors: agriculture, tourism, manufacturing, construction. These are all sectors that have built our economy, mining, logging. And our commitment is to ensure that we work with these sectors and to grow them. At the same time, we are growing our oil and gas economy. So my brothers and sisters, I said that the president navigated us through two of the most difficult periods in the history of our country, not only today, but since we know this country. One was COVID, and the second one, I'm sure you are very concerned about too, is the claim by Venezuela over our territory that you sit in here, your home. And the president must be commended for his stewardship and his leadership in ensuring that the world knows that Essequibo belongs to Guyana. That Guyana is 83,000 square miles. That is what we know, that is what we believe, and that is what we have. That is our country. So my brothers and sisters, let us continue working together. Today we are seeing massive changes and transformation in our country. And your village is not being left behind. The first time I came to NAPI was in 2011. And I can tell you that from 2011 to today, I've seen changes, massive changes in your community. You live here, you know that better. I want to close by urging you, especially the young people, to prepare yourself for the opportunities that are coming your way. Our country is changing, it is transforming. Another 6 years from today, Guyana will not be the same. There will be massive development throughout the entire country. Because many times we believe that development is only happening in Region 4. Well, not under our president. Development will take place in all 10 regions of our country. and in every single community in those regions. That is the president and his government commitment to you. So for the young people especially, prepare yourselves to take advantage of those opportunities. And how do you prepare yourself? You have no other than the Minister of Education here with us today. And Minister would outline some of the opportunities that our ministry is presenting, because you prepare yourself by acquiring a sound education or a life skill. Or a life skill. I know that the senior, so I don't like saying old, the senior folks here, our senior villagers, you never had the opportunities because those were the tough times in the 70s and 80s. But it's not that you don't have the ability, it's just that you didn't have the opportunity. Today, our young people, you have far more opportunity. You have far more opportunities. Make use of it. Take advantage of it. We want an educated population, because that is the fastest way we are going to develop our country. For the senior people, senior villagers, there is also a course on the Gold Scholarship for you. So even you are not left out. I think the course is called a Bachelor Preparatory Program. It is a 6-month course that you can do. And once you pass that program, you can actually sign up for a diploma or degree program. So please take advantage of that. Even the people with the technical skill, there's motorcycle training, cooking training, mechanic training. These are all opportunities that are available to you. So please, you know, sometimes we say that people are lucky and some are unlucky. Well, unfortunately, I don't believe in that. The people who we consider being lucky are the ones who grab the opportunities when it is presented to them. And the ones who cry in the corner and say they are unlucky are the ones who look at the opportunities and turn away. Let us be the ones that grab the opportunities. Thank you.
Thank you, Honorable Minister Vikram Bharat, for your wonderful remarks. Minister has regaled us with a mouthful indeed. I hope we have digested all that he has said and taken it to heart. And at the same time, I do hope that you have left space, enough space, for our Honorable Minister of Education, the Honorable Priya Manichan, to offer her remarks. Put your hands together, ladies and gentlemen.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chair. Mr. President, colleague, minister, regional chairman, or honorary council, and to everyone here, to Shao senior leaders, parents, and most particularly our children. Napi is an extremely special village for us. You gave us a national treasure in Michelle Abraham Ali, and the country gets to enjoy a piece of Napi almost every single day at international events. She chairs programs beautifully and flawlessly. And as her mother, you must be very proud, and this village must be very proud of her, as proud as we are of her in the government. We also have Michelle. Well, everybody knows Michelle, but Michelle, stand up and take that bow you so deserve. And we... And we also have a birthday with us, a birthday boy. Come. Do we have any other birthdays in the audience today? So here we're going to sing him happy birthday, led by His Excellency President Ali. So the president is singing happy birthday for you. 2, 3. Happy birthday.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, happy birthday, happy birthday to you. May the good Lord bless you. May the good Lord bless you. May the good Lord, may the good Lord, may the good Lord bless you. Hep hep. Hep hep.
So we are here today after 2 days of being in the region that continues the work that President Ali started. And it's very, we're always exuberant, and President brings a lot of energy to any meeting he has, and it's easy to get lost in that kind of happiness and forget where we came from. So I'm going to tell you, in 2020, I was sent to Region 9 to help tell you what the PPP would do and hear from you what it is you wanted if you were to put us back into government. And for some of that trip, Brian, your regional chairman, drove me. And for some, Roger drove me. And on one of the trips, I don't think Roger would mind, on one of the days, we were going from Lethem to Shelton, and Roger actually had diarrhea. So we had to stop several times, and he had to run off into the bush. You remember that? And that day, the vehicle broke down, and we were just in this wide expanse. And then that night, we got lost when we were coming back, because we drove through some strange savanna. But we did all of that because it was important to hear from you, to hear from the people of Region 9, all over Region 9, what it is you thought would help make your life and your children's life better. And you told us on that trip that you had seen, this was 2020, an increased presence of the APNU, AFC, in your village in 2019. And you said you felt that presence was there because of the no confidence motion that had happened in December 2018, but that you didn't see them before. You told us how life had become so hard that you had begun bartering again with Normandy. Do you remember those days? And you told us, and I remember those meetings, not as large as these, some of them smaller, but where you had books writing down what you wanted us to do and recording the commitment you thought we were making. And I hope you have seen that every single year since we got into government, without an election in sight, without any kind of motion that would take us to an election, we have been back to your villages, village by village, region by region, no lesser a person than His Excellency President Irfan Ali. And that is the PPPC's commitment to you. You will see us if we're in opposition. You will see us if we're in government. And every time you see us, it will be to hear you and to bring to you goodness that could make sure your children live a better life than you. And so we're not here. We're not fair weather friends. We're not friends only in the good times. We're not friends only when we have good things to tell you. We come when the times are hard also. And that, for me, my friends, in this time, on this Easter weekend, on this Easter Saturday, which you are calling Holy Saturday, that is a story of love. That is our story of commitment. And there's no better time to tell it than when Jesus died for us. In my view, he died so that we may live and live our best life. But you have to rely on those in government to give you the platform to live your best life. And we hear all the time we hear, oh, and you're getting some internet now and you're getting some TV now. So you're hearing a lot of noise and you're hearing a lot of opinions. And that's good. That's good. But you're hearing how we're doing these things because we have oil. And they couldn't do it because they didn't have oil. Isn't that so? They got oil now. That's why they're doing these things. In 1992, when the PPPC came to government, We were paying 95% of every dollar we earned in debt. So we weren't the richest country then. We were a very indebted country. In fact, they had a name for us, HIPIC, heavily indebted poor country. And from then we began to build out schools. So in the hinterland regions, 1, 7, 8, and 9, we had one secondary school when we came to office in 1992. In 92, between 92 and 97, we built 3 secondary schools in the hinterland without oil money. In 97 to 2001, we built 5 secondary schools in the hinterland without oil money. In the 2000s, the United Nations declared Guyana as having universal primary education without oil money. And to the senior citizens now, if you're 65 now, you would have been 30 then. So you weren't thinking of senior citizenship as you're living your best life, still on honeymoon and so on, right? So you wouldn't know that people like you in 1992 couldn't get an old age pension. You couldn't get it. You had to have a party card, a PNC party card, and you had to be means tested, and so none of you got old age pension. As soon as the PPP came into office, without oil money, heavily indebted poor country, we said every single old age person will get an old age pension. So I'm trying to show you that we don't give excuses and we don't make excuses about service. We try to make sure we serve equally and we serve equitably. And it's very easy, especially in those days when there was no internet and no cameras, it was very easy not to come here. It was very easy to ignore these parts, but we never did. And led by President Ali, he's insisting that before 2025, before his first term, he has plans for his second term, but before his first term, Region 9 will have all the nursery schools they need, all the primary schools they need, and all the secondary schools they need. And so I'm very glad to tell you that very shortly, we're going to begin building the Simone Nursery, Kotata Nursery. You know those places? You're here from Simone and Kotata. And we have a very special announcement. We're building a secondary school right here in Napi. A secondary school for your children right here in Napi. So the Michellas wouldn't have to leave home and go to Saints anymore, the third best school in the country. The Michellas, the young boy we just sang happy birthday for, and these children sitting here, they'll be able to stay here, enjoy your good nutrition, enjoy your loving care, and go to a secondary school and get a solid education right here in your village. That is President Ali's commitment to you. And after we have the schools, we want to make sure we have teachers in the schools. And so we are training right now as we speak 14 teachers from NAPI. 14 teachers right here. 3 from Simone, 5 from Kotata, 3 from Quarry Village, 3 from Mokomoko. Several hundreds of teachers are being trained right in their village because we want to make sure when the school comes and the bench and desk goes into the school that we have trained teachers standing there to teach your children. So my friends, when we come and we tell you we love you, we tell you we're committed, and we tell you that we will never leave you, those words have meaning. They have meaning. We're not just telling you that. It's not lyrics. It's not words. They have meaning. Now, let me tell you the comparison. You had 5 years of the APNUAFC. In that time, you said you had begun bartering with Normandy. In those 5 years, they failed, neglected, refused to build, start and finish one single secondary school in this country. So they finished none in the whole country. not in 1789 or anywhere else in Guyana. We are currently building about 34 secondary schools across Guyana to make sure all our children can access secondary education. So love is an action word. You got to do love. You must feel love. Your children must be better, because what are you living for? All of you here are living as parents. What do you want? You want the same thing I want for my children. You want the same thing President Ali wants for his children. Your children must have a life that is better than yours. Isn't that what you want? A life of plenty, a life of no struggle, a life where they could get jobs and be happy and productive and earn. That's what you want for your kids. And that is what Irfan Ali says. He's going to work hard every day to bring to you. So whether you see him in your village or not, whether you see us here or not, I want you to know we are working every day for you. And so shortly, in about 2 months, every single child in this village, every child, not every home, will receive $4,000 to $5,000 so that you could get help to buy your uniform. That's the Because We Care cash grant. You remember the other people, the APNU, APNU, they abolished it. And they said they would give you buses for your children to go to school. How many of your children are going to school in buses? How many in boats? None. So they squashed that program and they replaced it with nothing. We have given more buses and more boats in the 3 years we are in. Plus, we restored the cash grant and we're giving it to every single child. And we increased it. And we increased it. Then we know you had a problem. Teachers would ask you for chalk, cardboard, markers, what else? Scotch tape, bleach. And you had to come out of your pocket. And you had to help the school do that. The president said, this is ridiculous. We don't want our parents struggling like this. So he has given us a grant where we're giving to every single school money independently to buy those things. So every school will get $5,500 per child, so that the school could purchase those things, so that you no longer have to come out of pocket to buy those things. So this is how there are very many ways. When we give the exercise books and the textbooks, you don't have to buy those. The truth is you couldn't buy it. You had to be able to go on a plane and go to Trinidad or get a credit card and go on Amazon and buy it. And many of us don't have that ability. So your children went without those textbooks. Now we're giving every single child in Napi the same textbook we're giving every single child in Georgetown. We're giving every single child at St. Ignatius the same textbooks we're giving every single child at Queen's College. And you're seeing the results. You're seeing the results. We've seen how St. Ignatius and Aishalton moved from 22% pass to 60-something percent pass last year. And that's big. It means more children were able to pass. Right now, in addition to the Napi Secondary, we're building a Mawaranao Secondary, a secondary in Tapachinga. We're finishing off the TVET Center at St. Ignatius. And we're building another secondary at Masara. So my friends, there's a lot in store for you. I'm just speaking about education. I didn't touch agriculture. I didn't touch women and human services. I didn't touch any of those because the real speaker here today is the president. But I wanted you to know that when we tell you we love you, we mean it. When we tell you we love you, we show you it. When we tell you we love you, we expect you to feel it in your pockets, in your homes, in your schools, in your villages. Our entire effort is to make sure children, the children of these villages and the young people of these villages have all the opportunity that is available, that are available, opportunities that are available everywhere else in the country. And we're in Region 9 today, but it's the same thing for Region 7 and Region 1 and Region 4 and Region 6. So the thing is, we do have to ask you something. You have a responsibility too. We are happy to bring these services. We consider it our duty, but we could only bring it if we're in a place where we're allowed to bring it. When we were in opposition, we could tell you what we would do, but we couldn't do it because we didn't have the hands of government. So you have a duty too. You have to partner with us. You have to do the right things when the right time comes so that you could keep this kind of goodness flowing. In other words, you have to choose. Every 5 years, you get a choice, a very important choice that you get to make. How do I want my life to look? Who has been serving me? Who seems to be the people who apply small resources when they don't have any and large resources when they do have it? Who are the people that apply resources to make our lives better? That's your job. Or is this to serve you, and serve you we will. But you have a job too, to look after yourself by choosing and look after your children by choosing the right leaders. So this morning, if you take nothing away from all I said, I just want you to remember that for us, love is an action word. For us, love means doing things for you. For us, love means that we will bring services and goodness and make sure your life and your children's lives get better. I thank you and God bless you all.
Thank you, Minister of Education, Honorable Priya Manichan. Do you feel the love? Do you feel loved? Yes. Do you love our president? Yes, we do. So, to show some of the little love that we have in action, I would like to welcome Parishara to perform a song. Parishara, I would like to welcome Parishara on stage to perform a song. All right, we will move on from Parishara as they have experienced some technical difficulties in that manner. But we are moving on with the program, and we're coming to the highlight of I would like to welcome a student of the NAPI Secondary to do the introduction of our guest speaker, His Excellency the President. The student of NAPI Secondary Department. Put your hands, ladies and gentlemen, as we welcome your student from the NAPI Secondary Department.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. It is with great honor and privilege that I am here to fulfill the very important task of introducing to you a very illustrious, dedicated, and visionary leader. He was born on April 25, 1980, into a Muslim Indo-Guyanese family at Lenora, West Coast Demerara, Region 3. This exemplary man is a patriot and a true son of the Guyanese soil, where he serves today as the 9th executive president of this great nation. His academic portfolio boasts several accolades, all noteworthy and too numerous to mention. He is a man dedicated to progress, to the progress and prosperity of our country, and stands at the helm of nationhood development with a steadfast commitment of to serving the people and improving the welfare of every Guyanese. He embodies the values of of integrity, compassion, and unity, as evidenced by his nationwide campaign under the One Guyana. Ladies and gentlemen, without further delay, please stand and give a loud round of applause and let us welcome His Excellency Dr. Mohamed Irfan Ali, President of the Cooperative Republic of Guyana, to deliver his address. Thank you.
Please have your seats. I think the kids have something they have to do.
Where did you come from? Where did you go? Where did you come from? Katnado. But I've been from Katnado. I've been married a long time ago. Where did you come from? Where did you go? But I've been from Katnado. I've been married a long time ago. Where did you come from? Where did you go? Where did you come from? Katnado. But I've been from Katnado. I've been married a long time ago. Where did you come from? Where did you go? Where did you come from? Katnado. After that beautiful performance, now comes my rusty voice. You know, I've been listening to the ministers, the two shows, the regional chairman, and everyone speak across the last 2 days about the development and advancement here in Region 9. But you know, we are in a government, and we are also people of faith. And in the cabinet, we have resigned ourselves to a few very important voices in different religious texts. Because in life, there will be many challenges. Sometimes in life, the road seems long and dreary. Sometimes it seems impossible, but I remind you in Luke 1:37. It says, "For nothing will be impossible with God. For the word of God will never fail. Nothing you see is impossible with God." And it is this teaching that we take as part of our mandate, that if nothing can be impossible with God, then we have to do everything to make it possible for all of humans. We have to make it possible to do everything in our powers within the cabinet to make it possible for you. Because we are blessed to be your servants. We are blessed to have received your love and your support and your commitment to be your servants. And as your servants, every day we go about our tasks to look at what may seem impossible, to stare it down the face and say, reminding ourselves, as you remind yourselves, that nothing is impossible with God. Let me hear you say that. Nothing is impossible with God. There comes a time in life when we streamline what we do here with the mandate we were given, when we assume our presence in this earthly place. But it's how we go about fulfilling this mandate. What are the important characteristics of fulfilling this mandate? And if you look at the approach of this government, if you look at the approach of the People's Progressive Party, Civic, in fulfilling its earthly mandate, it reminds me of Hebrews 13:8, when it says, "Jesus is the same yesterday, the same today, and the same forever." The People's Progressive Party, Civic, is the same yesterday, the same today, and will be the same forever. Because we believe in love, we believe in patience, we believe in working with you, we believe in embracing you, we believe in the totality of life, and in the totality of life, we must lift each other up. In the totality of life, none of us can be superior than the other. Because we are all humbled by the same common ground. That is, when it comes before the superior being, we are all brought to our knees as equals, as part of the human family. And it's this principle that characterizes the PPP civic government. Understanding that we are all equal. Understanding that we are all imperfect. But also understanding that faith without work is dead. And understanding that in the realization of the objective of service, we must work and work hard every day and work hard in your interest. And that is what we have done every single day. We must understand that leadership is not just the exercise of a vote. Leadership is ordained. Leadership has specific attributes and values to it described by a superior being. And we cannot claim to love God if we don't exercise the values that is ordained in accordance with leadership. For this reason, this cabinet that I lead, and as your chief servant, I find the greatest honor, the greatest happiness when I am with you. It can be on a holiday, it can be on a day when I am not in full spirit, but when I am with you, the people, I'm uplifted. I'm uplifted because I love being with you. And when you speak about love, love that is unconditional, love that does not wait, love that is not boastful, love that is patient and kind, that is the love we seek to give in this government. And I'll give you a recent example of the love I speak about. No community asked us about cassava. But we knew that you're suffering because of the weather and the cassava crop was bad. Am I not right? Yeah. And the heat destroyed the cassava. And what did we do? Without you asking, 3 days ago, although we did not plan for it, we did not budget for it, 3 days ago, we delivered 500,000 pounds of cassava to Deep South. $20 million. And in the coming week, in your 8 communities in this subsector, we will deliver another 500,000 pounds of cassava valued at $20 million. That is even without the transportation costs. But I told the REO to support you in these villages, to have sustainability and to have excess production and to have value added. Even without you asking, we are going to install a cassava mill and we will start it within 14 days right here to service these communities around here. Another $20 million investment. By the time we are finished on this one initiative alone, by the time we are finished, we will spend more than $100 million that we did not budget for, but which occurred and is expended because of the love we have for you and the love you have shared with us. Let there be no mistake. Let there be no mistake. Because in the time of the early Christians and the Jews and the people of the book, we were warned about false prophets and false prophecy. And we were told about what characterizes false prophets and false prophecy. That is why we were led to understand the difference between false and what is right. That is why the important verse of seek and you shall find. Because it is only when you seek the knowledge, you will be able to understand who are the false prophet and prophecy that comes before you and try to destroy what we are building. And let's look at it. Let's look at a few examples. My respected elders, my brothers and sisters, let us look at a few examples. Today, there are some who claim to be righteous and upright, who claim to be the custodian and transparency and fearlessness. But 43.5 years ago, these very persons tried to steal an election, tried to steal your vote, tried to impose themselves upon the people when they were not elected as a government by the people. That is the truth. And they have the audacity to claim honesty and dignity and transparency and fairness. How weak is thy soul to give them a chance to make this claim? Now I can understand if they come before you and they say, we have wronged, forgive us. Because then we are mandated by the word to forgive them. But if you can't own up to your mistake and say, we were wrong, we tried to steal the elections, forgive us, then how can we forgive you? You see, there's a difference. Although we did so much, and in 2015, the people of the country gave us, said, take a break, reflect, and come back. In 2015, we took a break, we reflected, and we came back. But one of the first things that we did as a political party was we came together and we said, we must go back to the people and let them tell us what they would like. We came back, we listened, we unlearned, we relearned, we repackaged, and here is it. We are back with you today, and in less than 4 years, we have fulfilled almost completely all the commitment we have made to you when we came to you in 2020. Everything else is bonus. Coming back to false narrative and falseness of character. Before 2020, before 2015, the very messengers of falsehood and hate, they said to the people, to you, that they will double the school children grant. And many people say, praise the Lord. Instead, what did they do? They took it away from the children. What manner of people, what manner of soul can steal from the children, can take away from the children, can look at a mother in the eye and say, I'm going to take this money out of your children's hand. Let us think deeply. Let us understand deeply what the truth is. And then came 2020, your government. And what did we say? We said initially, until Manichan opened our big mouth, that we will increase it incrementally to 40,000, Priya. But then Priya went on the platform and said 50. And I just followed. I just follow, comrades. But we understand that our word is our bond. And I want to say to you today that your children, we will ensure they get exactly what we promise. Whether you have 10 children, 2 children, 1 children, 15 children, go on and multiply the flock. because we are going to deliver to every single child. Even your humble servant, not giving up on multiplying the flock. This is a government that cares. Look at our pensioners. Not only did we increase the pension and we'll continue to increase it, but guess what? The first country in the world that gave bonus pension at the end of the year. Put your hands together, bonus pension. By the mercies that you have granted us, we could not have done any of this without you. I want you to remember this. We could not have done any of this without you, because it is you. It is your vote. It is your love. It is your commitment that allowed us, your chief servant, the opportunity to do this for you. Put your hands together for yourselves. Put your hands together for yourselves. Celebrate yourself. Celebrate your vote. Celebrate your love. Celebrate your commitment. Celebrate your dedication. Celebrate who you are. Uncle, stand up and show them who you are. With the red shirt, stand up. Stand up and show them who you are. Stand up and face the crowd. Turn around. Turn around. Turn around. One country, one people, one future. Model it and show them. Model it. Now, there's a reason why I asked Uncle to stand. You know why? It takes a special kind of love, a special kind of dedication and care for Uncle to save that shirt for 4 years. And thousands of you in the hinterland, in this region especially, would turn up proudly with your shirt. Some from 15 years ago. Put your hands together for this type of dedication and love. You see, sometimes we take for granted the simple things in life. And sometimes we fail to value the simple things in life. Let me give you another example. All night last night, rightfully so, let me be very clear, rightfully so, I received all blissful messages about GPL. That is a Ghana Power and Light, because they're having technical difficulties for the last 24 plus hours. And I'm in the interior, enjoying the beauty of nature, and I'm receiving all these texts. And it brought me to a point of reflection. And I say this by acknowledging that they're right. And we are correcting it. I'm not going to hide my head, and we're not like that. They are correct. And I take no insult at the hurt that people are facing and feel because of this. But you know what came to my mind? You. Because I'm here. And I said, for all your lives, most of you here, you've lived without electric power. You've lived without electric power. But by the grace of God and by the strength of character,
you have produced some of our finest. You have accepted life challenges and you have converted it into opportunity. So much so that today, for the first time, you're receiving your solar household power. But it is a lesson. You see, my brothers and sisters, there's a guy who I like to read about, and I read a lot of his work. He is Sheikh Maktoum from the UAE. And he said something. He said, my great-great-grandfather rode a camel. My grandfather rode an upgraded camel. I drove a Mercedes Benz. My son drive a Mercedes Benz and a Range Rover. My grandchildren will drive a Maserati, a Ferrari, and a Mercedes Benz. But my great-great-grandchildren will ride a camel again. And what was he talking about? What he was trying to demonstrate is that because of the successive improvement in generation, the value system changes. The value for the camel went, the value for one car went, the value for two car went, the value for three car went, until they will outspend themselves and they will have to go right back to the camel. That is why we have to be very careful. And we have to spend on what is right, what is transformative, what is good for these children and their future. And what is that? Education, healthcare, water and infrastructure, housing. And not rent the house. Oh my God, in this day and age, you'll come and tell the people you're going to pay your rent. We started a program in 2009, called the Hinterland Housing Program, where we started to build homes in the hinterland. Then we started the Hinterland Electrification Program. These are the investment we have to make. But we also have to value the investment. You know, you go to some communities now. In my younger years, the first time I started to work in this region, I was only 17 years old. We used to come here under the BNTF program. And when we come under the BNTF program, you know what used to be the request? These young people working now, they should hear this. The request in these communities used to be for cutlass and files. Remember that here? Remember the request? Cutlass and files. Tractor seems non-existent. Much less ATV. We built from cutlass and file to fork to plow to chainsaw, to plow and tractor, the four-wheel drive tractor, the ATV. That's how. Am I not right? The solar system. And now today when you come, we don't only want water, we want the extension of the services. We don't want only one solar system, we want internet. We don't only want internet, we want telephone. And nothing is wrong with this, because we now have that hope that we can aspire to be the best we can be, and we can aspire to be right on the same level as those on the coastline. And this government will make the investment to make sure that you are at that same level. Somebody say praise God. Let me hear you. I'm not telling you to praise man, I'm saying praise God. But in sending praises to God, you have to acknowledge those who he created and are fulfilling his work and are fulfilling his duty. And the People's Progressive Party Civic was created as an organization, and everything is possible with God, and nothing happens without the knowledge of God. So he must have knew that the PP Civic was created. Praise God! And if he knew this, and this is ordained in his will, then how are we fulfilling the responsibility that is entrusted in us? And demonstrating to you how we're fulfilling this responsibility. We are deeply concerned now with this dry weather, the effect it is having on your water system, and all of this. Deeply concerned. That is why the entire GWI team, they're out here. We want you to get the best medical facility. That is why we have a telemedicine program here. We want your children to be the best they can be. That is why today you have thousands of Amerindian children registered and studying to become nurses, trained teachers, medical technicians, doctors. Hope has brought the realization of success for your communities under the People's Progressive Party Civic Government. Together, we will build faster, we will build better, and we will build safer together. Understand this. Understand that this is a journey of togetherness. We have to walk together in love and unity. We have to together commit ourselves to the philosophy and ideas of the People's Progressive Party Civic, so that we can continue to deliver to you. So that your servants can continue to deliver to you. My friends, it reminds me of Philippians 1:6. Be confident of this, that he who began good work in you will carry it on to completion. This is not me, brothers. This is in the book of Philippians. He who began good work in you will carry it on to completion. And this is an oath we are taking before the Creator, that the good work that we started, the good work that we're doing, we will carry on to completion. Somebody say praise God. Today is Holy Saturday. And I committed myself. When I left, I asked Carl, would we affect the fellowship of our brothers and sisters? And he said, our brothers and sisters are waiting with love for you. And I said, all I want to do is to give them love and share in that love. And today, I'm pleased to see in all the communities, hundreds of you coming out. And I said to myself, we must make this also a time of fellowship. Because I have enormous respect. And in all we do, if we acknowledge that God is among us, then in all we do, we cannot fail to include Him. Am I right? I know my respected regional chairman, my elder, is a man of the book and a preacher of the word. And I take my guidance from him on these matters. But those are special qualities that our regional chairman brings with him. Our REO, Claire, all the leaders, they work so hard. Many times I want to bring your REO out of here. Because he has a capacity and capability. Together, we will make wonders. Together, we will build a region that every corner of Guyana will know. We will build communities that every corner of Guyana will grow to love. We'll bridge every gap and we'll pave every journey into a successful future for all of you. To support your villages, there are 6 initiatives that we're looking to implement this year. The first is called the Buyer's Hub. Through the Men on Mission, we'll come to this region when you have all your excess mangoes and fruits, and we'll procure those mangoes and fruits so that we can have a constant market for you and we'll buy your excess production. We want to develop cultural hubs. We want to develop educational hubs. The minister will tell you that we're going to expand our facilities so that we'll have hubs that the girl students can go and study, that the trained teachers can go and study, online examination centers, food support integration hubs. But importantly, there are some young people too here that are going to work with this region in the establishment of mental health hubs. Where's Jesse and Sarah? I'll come forward. Let them see you. They will work with the Ministry of Health on establishing mental health hubs. But more importantly than that, we have launched a program in this year's budget where we are giving a voucher to every woman so that they can go and do their scans for cervical cancer. Show me one government that cares this much. And through the Men on Mission program, they will launch very shortly a program that would enable men to be educated and for them also to go and do their prostate checkup. But we did not only work on this grant for the cervical cancer, but importantly, we're investing in the equipment to ensure that you get the treatment also. Isn't this love? Isn't this a government that cares? I can go on and on. But I will stop by reminding you of a few things over the last 4 years. I remind you that we almost lost 1.5 years of our government because we came in at the time of COVID. And even during that time, we never stopped working. We did not close government down. Priya will tell you, we printed, what we call them, worksheets. Remember how we kept your children in school? Remember how we kept their children learning? We knew that they didn't have access to the internet. But as a cabinet, we did not want your children to be left behind. And we went and we invested in learning sheets, testing papers, and we brought it to your children. We did not promise this or plan this, but we did this. Isn't that love? Isn't that love? Isn't that compassion? Isn't that caring? In the last 3 years, among your communities here, which is about 3,842 persons or 850 households, we have invested almost $500 million. In health, we've invested about $90 million. In education, more than $140 million. In renewable energy, more than $57 million. In ICT, more than $25 million. In tourism, more than $8 million. In agriculture, more than $45 million. In sports, more than $5 million. In housing and water, more than $50 million. In human services, almost $2 million. But we are proud of this investment because these investments are made to make your life better, to make your life easier. And if there is a soul in this country or in this region that can tell me with a clear conscience that their life has not improved or gotten better in the last 3 years, and I pray God have mercy upon us all. I thank you and God bless you.
Ladies and gentlemen, put your hands once more, a bigger round of applause for His Excellency, the President of the Cooperative Republic of Guyana, Dr. Mohamed Irfan Ali. At this point in time, the floor is now open to the members of the public to, if you have any questions or any requests or some, you want to express your love to the president, as we all want to do, you can just raise your hand and I will carry the microphone to you. State your name, where you're from.
Good morning, Our Excellency, the team, Tushos, villagers, all comrades. Good morning. I am here to tell our Excellency that we need what we want for our children. Also, I'm a farmer and also I'm a member of the PPP Civic, but I forget my story. So, my Excellency, I'm here standing in front of you. We requesting the member of the party requesting bus for children for Parshara, Hayawa. They are suffering during the rainy season, especially secondary children, am I talking about? And what I requested long when you were right here, when you was presidential candidate, we need back our land, what the previous government take away from us, from Chico Place. So we need back the same one now, because you told us, you promised us that when we get the power, you're going to get your land. Now we are in power now. We're going to get it. We're going to get the land now. We're going to get the land now. Secondly, the pensioners, they need transportation. We want many bus for them too. Because we don't have no bus for in our community. So we need many bus for pensioners to go to Latin, to buy vaccine and medicine. Secondly, thirdly,
Uncle, you sure you need a bus for the pensioners of the Lyman Latham? Because you got the medicine right there, you know, and the pension pay right there. But it's okay, you're going to enjoy yourself in Latham too there, you know.
No, you see, we don't have one boss.
No, I know, I'm just joking.
Yeah, I know that. Because we have private vehicles, sometimes 1 or 2 days we have to, the patient have to wait, the client to come, we have the charging me $2.50, one head. If I go with my wife now,
No, the pension has to be paid in the village. Is the pension being paid in the village, Carl?
Yes.
Right, so it's being paid in the village. Right, so you don't have to pay anything. The pension is being paid right in the village now. We give that order.
My Excellency, yes. We get it paid in our village, but where to come by ration? We don't have no big shop right in our community. So we have to go to Latin to buy ration. All right, we need agriculture visit our community every 2 months. Because now, I heard you mention cassava. Our cassava now are full of caterpillars, destroying our crops, our cassava. So we need poison or spray can to spray our cassava due to the caterpillar. I would like to thank our Excellency about our housing scheme done. 10 only. Because we have 59 house applied for the housing scheme. Well, I was to talk about the fire, but fire says Excellency come it out in me. Well, let me thank my Excellency for solar panel. Let me thank our Excellency for tractor, canter, and our buckle of where standing up. What come yesterday? Recent. A new one. So we thank my people. Let me give Napi, Parshara, and Iowa give a big hand for our president. I thanks for the power, sir, what you did. By when? 2019. I remember. It's I asked for it, and I got it. On the 2nd of October 2019. Thank you, my Excellency, President. Thank you.
His Excellency Dr. Muhammad Irfan Ali and the members of the head table, very pleasant good morning to you. My name is Eleanor Brown. I am from Cotato Primary. Well, I am here making presentations not only on behalf of the school but on behalf of the village. We were invited, first of all, thank you very much for inviting us, Dr. Holly, to be here. Other agriculture in Cotato Village, you know, Cotato Village is beer savanna, and we are suffering, especially the farmers. And so I have written a letter through the regional chairman for the plowing of savanna lands to do farming. And it is there, I'm not sure if he had followed it up, but we need our farms to be plowed and to be fenced. And there is water problem as well. So as you were saying, years ago, NAPI was asking for cutlasses on file.
Okay, by Wednesday, you're getting the plow.
Thank you
very much. By Wednesday, you're getting the plow, okay?
Thank you very much. And that is under, so not only the plow, so as you were saying, cutlasses and files were requested for years ago. So we are asking now for an excavator for to dig the wells for the farmers right now. And our cattle and other farmers are suffering and under education. Our school hot meal kitchen need to be renovated and extended. I have asked Mr. Carl Sim, our REO, send him a message. I just see he read my message. He didn't say yes or no. I was asking who I should write my proposal to.
It's been done, right? P.S. It's been done on Marine Affairs, right? Yes, this is programmed for under the Ministry of Marine Affairs.
Okay.
Right?
Well, he should have told me at least something like that, but he didn't tell me anything. So that need to be renovated.
One second. Hold. Let me get the PS to say a few words.
So we would have issued a tractor and plow to the village, plow and implement, tractor, trailer, plow, implement. What you need probably is assistance with fuel to plow the land. That's what you're asking for?
Not really.
Yes,
Chairman was saying a bigger plow and...
You want, no, the plow that we give the every village in this region receive a tractor, plow, and chipper from the Ministry of Marine Affairs. The plow is to boost the food security in agriculture. It is sufficient to plow the land that you have here in Region 8. You don't need a bigger plow than that. Region 9, sorry. So the plow and tractor is sufficient for agriculture in your region, Region 9 here.
Yes.
You're right. So you have the equipment already. So the village council just has to manage it a little bit better. If the residents are requesting, it's the council that's managing the piece of equipment. So you have the equipment already that you're asking for.
Yes. So maybe the fuel and the fencing that I'm asking for. Regional chairman knows about it, man. He will explain it to you better. And so that is it. So I was saying the kitchen, it is not, it needs to be renovated. And it was painted in green, a dark color green. And I was visited by the health officials the other day, and it is not at that standard. Even my school is painted in green. And remember, you visited 13th of March, 2022. You said it will be repainted. It was never done. So it is in green color.
We're painting all the schools in the region this year. Right? So, I wonder why you paint this thing in green anyhow.
I'm not me.
Okay. I know it's not you. Anything you paint is red. All right, good. So, we'll get it corrected.
So, my school, since it was built to, it was never fenced. So, fencing need to be done. And under health, when it will be... upgraded to health center. Remember, the building is there. I just want to find out how long it will take to be functioning there with nurses and doctors and so on. And the housing project. Thank you.
We're upgrading your Bukari now. to a health center, right?
Thank you very much.
Good.
And the housing project, we are about 80% completed, the housing scheme project. Thank you very much for responding. And as Len, I have a little request to make. As you said, I'm happy that you're very religious, and I heard you are quoting a lot of Bible scriptures. So I'm going to quote another one for you here. In Matthew 7:7 says, ask and it will be given unto you. So I am requesting here, under my, as an HR,
remember the Bible also said, everything in good time. So it shall be given, but everything in good time. For
yes,
there is a season for everything.
And yes, so my request here is, as a head teacher, and not only myself, I don't know if my colleagues are wrong, but to do administrative work, well, for me, I use my own laptop, my phone, and sometimes we are asked to complete tasks quickly. So I'm kindly asking if head teachers around here, even everybody, can be given a laptop, and I also need a printer for my school. And the Wi-Fi, my colleague here is saying, ask for Wi-Fi, miss. Anyway, the Wi-Fi at my school, it is functioning. Although the moving.
Remember the word also say that you mustn't ask for all yourself, but then people get something for themselves, right? You gotta share them.
That's why he's saying, no, she is saying. And so that is what I need for my school, a laptop and a printer. And I have been teaching grade 6 since I started to teach. But just for last year now, and thank you, the government, for employing teachers at every school. So I have 8 of us now. I still need one more. So I was able to assign a teacher to every class, and I'm very thankful. So but I do guide. I do love to teach grade 6, and there are a lot of programs online for grade 6 and even CSEC to do, like online revision and so on. So I was trying to hook up my grade 6 children. I don't have plenty, I only have 6. And I had a problem. The children came, they brought their tablets, just 2 of them. I had to use my children and even my phone, but I couldn't get through to do the revision of English paper 2 online because they had to get a phone and a SIM. So my parents are very unfortunate. Only one child had. So we were not able to do that program. And anyway, the exam is coming close and we are working. But for the other children that are coming, and even the whole school, I only have 60 children. I'm kindly requesting for tablets for the children, so that they can have educational studies at home. We do have the TV, but that only happens in the school. So that is what
right.
I want for my children. Just now, Mr. President, I have one more to say.
Let's give everybody an opportunity.
One highlight. In our area, there are many communities, and we have been saying this a lot of times at different meetings, at general meetings. How about building a secondary school in our area for the other satellite communities? That is just a highlight that you should consider too. That is all from me. Thank you very much for listening.
Thank you. Let us not repeat ourselves, and let us give way so we can have as much persons, right?
His Excellency, Dr. Mohamed Irfan Ali, and members of the head table, I stand before you today with immense gratitude on behalf of the entire village, which includes Haiwan Parishara, for the remarkable development initiatives that has been unfolding under your visionary leadership. Your commitment to fostering progress and prosperity has not only transformed our community, but has also instilled hope and optimism in the hearts of our citizens. Your Excellency, the strides we have witnessed in our community are a testament to your steadfast resolve to uplift the lives of every citizen. The development projects ranging from the recently constructed road and the secondary school that will soon be built, we thank you. The aquaculture project that will soon be implemented, we want to say thank you. For the LCDS funds that we benefited from, we would like to say thank you. With that, we did some cattle ranch project, and we started a cassava planting project as well, and intend to do that as a seed bank in these challenging times. We also use that for cultural support. And also we thank you, as was mentioned, for bringing the pensioners' money to the community, which is of great help to our senior citizens. And we are so grateful, Mr. President, for what you are doing, for the announcements that you made today. I know every villager will go home with a grateful heart, knowing that, yes, we have a government that cares. I would also like to mention what our senior citizen, Uncle Randolph John, mentioned of our proposed land extension. We expect an answer today, Your Excellency. During your reign, you still have some time. And we would like to hear from you in relation to our proposed land extension. Also, we thank you for your support during this dry season and the wildfires that have ravaged our crops. Instead of having cassava, we would like the cassava sticks be Mr. President, seated under this Benaban out there, we have our youths. They asked me, they said, kindly remind His Excellency of his promise when he was here during his campaign trail to upgrade our sport facilities.
And so I'm here in front of them, reminding you, Mr. President, of that promise, of your commitment, as you rightly said.
To show, we started that, we give some zinc and the fuel and so on, right? But what we will do is tell them to set aside another maybe $3.5 million to help with the upgrade, further upgrade of the facility, right?
Thank you, Mr. President. Youths. Also, Mr. President, I see my colleagues here ranging from Yapakari way down to Hayao. We have been lobbying for the connecting of our communities with the road. And so they are here today. They asked me to just present this once again before His Excellency. So here I bring our request before you for all my colleague communities today. And we have been following you, Mr. President, with your Men on Mission initiative. And we are therefore proposing a youth conference for young men, and this will be dedicated to empowering them in our communities. And this proposed conference will aim to provide a platform for dialogue and mentorship, thereby equipping our youth with the tools and resources to become agents of positive change in our communities. We humbly request your support and endorsement of this noble proposal.
Yes, this is perfect. So I'll ask Ario to work with you and start planning it, and we'll get this done.
Thank you, Mr. President. Also, I would not like to forget our security, I call them our security forces in the community, our community policing, the group there. We request, Mr. President, for adequate transportation facilities for them. And as you said, you mentioned today, some bonus for our volunteers. You can see them standing out there in uniform, in hot sun, doing what they have to do for the security of our community.
And to show on the road network, on the Ministry of Public Works, we've started some work. We're spending $125 million on these very road networks that you talk about, okay?
Thank you, Mr. President. In conclusion, His Excellency, I reiterate our profound appreciation for your unwavering commitment to the progress and prosperity of our village. As we navigate the challenges and opportunities that lie ahead, we remain confident in your leadership and vision to steer us towards a brighter future. Together, let us continue, Mr. President, to strive for excellence, inclusivity, and sustainable development, ensuring that no citizen is left behind in our journey towards prosperity. Thank you.
Good morning, Your Excellency. I am Maximus Griffith, a volunteer councillor of Iowa Village, and I'm here on behalf of the people of Iowa Village. Most of the previous speakers already talked on some points that I listed, but what I want to highlight, that's for the ranchers, as I'm a farmer also. We have like 8 ranchers in the village, and some of the animals are suffering without water. And when it comes to human consumption, water for human drink, there is only one well that was drilled, 2 wells that were drilled. One was dried up, I guess, and the other one is...
We're doing one this year also.
So if they could
right
get...
Right in Iowa? Yes, sir. Where are we doing it?
Right in Iowa.
Right in Iowa,
there is one, but not functioning as yet.
No, we're doing, because it dried up. So we're doing another well this year, right?
It's already drilled.
Yes, you're right. We just finished drilling the second well in Iowa, and we're working, our team is working to complete in-house work, the distribution system in Solid Pump, within 1 month.
Good. I would like to request for one more, because there is only for the central part. Like West Iowa will also need one drill well. Thank you very much.
Okay, our team will come in and do that assessment for that next request.
Good. And same thing with the fires, as you could see from here, there is fires up the mountain. And right now it's destroying our forest, and I'm an environmental person as well. So I feel for the Kanaku Mountains. I don't know what we could try to work together with the government of Guyana to help us maybe get rid of fires when it starts to blaze up the mountains. And when it comes to school, we need more teachers. And for Iowa Primary School, the school was renovated recently, but we still need like upgraded school. No proper ventilation, no proper lighting in the school, and the floor is concrete and is very dusty. So we need the floor to be tiled. That's the complaint from the teachers.
We're doing over that entire building this year.
Thank you very much. Teacher's quarters, we need some more teacher's quarters. There is only one old one, which we'll be trying to renovate it with our PG grant next year, this year probably get. But we need like 2 more so that we could accommodate teachers from other communities. Because during the rainy season, they always punish because the roads become flooded. And that's it, I guess. Thank you very much, Mr. President. Thank you for doing all the good work and continue to do the good work that you have always done. Thank you very much.
Good morning, His Excellency, Head Table. I am Joseph Charles, Senior Conflict Health. I am going straight to the point concerning water system, and which I brought most times to the GWI, and they would understand. Because we were given a pipe to extend to the school, but then it would not work because of the energy, I think. The stressful is in the school building is not filled, it's empty. And it is, I want, please, you have to take this as a prayer so that the school children and teachers must benefit out of it, because it is there just as something like just standing there without any water in it. So that is it. Also, some household, you know, Flahil is a small community, but coming up community. So there is household, other house building up. So I would just request for another drill well. So other people must benefit out of it. Also, His Excellency, infrastructure upgrading of the road been made, but it was only 3 kilometers, which to me it is not really beneficial, satisfied, because it was just a short road, and which I expect that would be joined to the Huantail Road, which a piece what left of there is just 3 kilometers more. So if this is considered His Excellency, I greatly appreciate that. So I am requesting that the road also be complete to the Huantail Road. Thank you.
Right, so just to let you know, we have 7 teachers at Hiawa, but because we had to send some, sir, Flahil, but because some had to go to CPC for training, you have less. But if you have anybody in the village who has the required subjects, let us know and we'll hire them, right? As teachers, okay? And there are repairs to the building that will, the teachers' quarters that are going to begin shortly. Flahil, right? The Hiawa teachers' quarters that will serve Flahil, right?
Teachers' quarters is Hiawa. That's what you thought. That's what Dennis is talking about.
His Excellency Dr. Ali, honorable ministers and the team, residents from the essential villages, a pleasant good day to all. My name is Shamar Khan. I'm Tusho of Yipkar Village, and also a rep at the National Tushos Council. First of all, I heard my colleague, Mr. Samuel, mention the road linkage from East Central Village, which I'm really happy to hear that the president mentioned that it's in the pipeline. But this had been raised 3 years ago, and only today I kind of feel satisfied that, you know, something has been done about it. Because now, with the LCDS funds that we're receiving, you can see a lot of people buying buses. But the terrain is very bad, I would say. But we need this road linkage, and I think it would make it easier for us to traverse the East Central Villages and all the way to Letton. Secondly, someone spoke about, I think it's the worst we have ever experienced with fire in this area. Last year at NTC, with the Vice President there, I talked about uncontrolled burning since we are receiving LCDS funds. I was talking about, you know, creating some kind of policies for fire management. But that was kind of like it was funny. They didn't take us serious. But today, what we are seeing, the mountain on fire, it hurts my heart. And I don't know how it's gonna be in the future in terms of LCDS funds because of the immense burning. You can see in our villages, it's sad. The other thing I would like to ask you for assistance, Mr. President, is to dig some reservoir for our livestock owners in Yupukari area. Yupukari and its satellite. Yupukari, Kwatata, Flahil, and Kaikumbe. Because the animals are looking for sufficient water in the swamps, and most of them are not coming back. They're dying there. So this is an urgent request. I would also request for 2 head teachers for Yupukari Primary School and the nursery school. because currently we have acting agents. So these are just few requests. There are many more, but I'll leave it here. And Mr. President, I want to commend you for all the hard work that you're doing for this entire country. I want you to know that we stand by you. We stand with you. We continue to support you. Continue to do the great work. Everyone, God bless you all, and thank you very much.
His Excellency, Minister, the comrades all, good morning. I would like to tell you a few words today concerning about the road to Parishara, because our school children are coming from Parishara to Napi, and I think this is supposed to, because I see it on this newspaper, you get $15 million for Parishara. So we need it urgently, and thank you for this, His Excellency. I don't get the money from this afternoon newspaper already. Thank you very much.
Okay. My name is Joseph Dorik. I'm from Kotata Village. I just want to say good afternoon, everyone, and excellently Dr. Irfan Ali at the table. I am here to say a short presentation about the road. I hear the two show and other colleagues were talking about the road linking through the main road to Parishara, Napi, Hiawa, to Letem. My concern is about, this is really a concern that we raised at the last meeting we had at the villagers together. The shortcut I'm talking about from Cribbon Bridge to Whiting Junction. We need that road to be upgraded, because we have been seeing it that this is right around driving through Mitizir and through Parishara coming in. It is a cost and it is a time. So we need this road to be regressed from Cribbon Bridge to that junction there, Whiting Junction. So it will reduce the time and the cost of the fuel. So that is what I am requesting for. So I would like to thank you if you take our request, President. So I would like to thank you that you have your commitment has fulfilled in Kwatata. You have seen a lot of changes in Kwatata. I see it personally from changes from 2020. We have the tractor, we have the IT, we have everything, almost everything we have. So we will continue to support you. Thank you very much.
Good day to the table. My name is Andrew Dimetro. His Excellency, I just wanted to echo the sentiments of the previous speakers. We are really honored by your visit here. I'm really thankful that the things that I had promised to mention, you all did a great job. I wouldn't go back to talk about this. However, I have a few concerns that I would really need to be addressed. One is the saying that the Minister of Education is here. We have a hot meal program at the school that has been started some years ago. We have really dedicated workers, Miss Ade, at the place. They are our mathematicians and our scientists in two locations, at home as well as at the workplace. They have expressed some kind of worry about their payments. No? We had a team from the school feeding program here on two occasions. It is great that this facility really is working. But their only concern is, and our concern, my concern here today, is the payment for these workers at the hot meals. As I said, they have to do their mathematics every day. How are they going to add, subtract, divide? And as I said again, at two locations, at home and at the workplace. So I am asking, Minister, that some kind of consideration be given to them so that not only our hot meal cooks here in Napi, but maybe the region. This is one. I see the PS for Ministry of Region Affairs is here. I heard presentations being made by our previous speakers, the two show and so on, about our LCDS. We are now about to enter into the second year of our LCDS disbursement, Your Excellency. What we have been thinking about is seeing that we have been affected seriously by this weather condition at the moment. One, I would like to support Tusho in that we may not need a cassava here. We want some planting material, please. Secondly, on the LCDS, the funding.
You will get the cassava stick.
Thank you, Mr. President. And the other one, as I think you mentioned, or somebody else mentioned from the head table, that you don't make promises, you make commitments. So I really respect you for that. And the other one is for our 2024 LCDS proposal, we are planning to work on a livelihood improvement program for the entire village and using it to do farming. Mr. President, we don't know what the amount is. What we have in Napi, we have 240 households, and we are targeting like 150,000 to support each farmer. This is what maybe my last request. And the other one, finally, I want to thank all the people here. Before I thank you, I want, as the Natural Resources Minister is here as well, we have a reservoir. Now we are at the peak of the dry season. Shortly, we will be right into the rainy season. When the waters rise, that dam sometimes looks very dangerous. We had requested by some meetings or at some meetings that those dams be supported, strengthened. And now is the time. So we are asking for some work to be done on the reservoir dam. Water has been eroding it for several years, but we need to strengthen it back. At least that has helped us, the people of Napi and the animals, to find drinking water there. This was the purpose of the reservoir. We want to thank you so much again, Your Excellency and your ministers, your visiting team. We want to thank you for all those security people that you have at the back. We don't need to lose you now. Guys, do your work. Secure our president. And we will be with you. We will stand with you as long as we are here. Thank you, Mr. President.
Good morning, everybody. My name is Matthew David from Parishara. Mr. Excellency, I would want to find out, really, not saying that, I want you to say yes, not no, yes, for everybody. Napi, Parishara, Haiwa, about road, farm to market road to the bush to my paima. Everybody always struggle during rainy season. Every year, school children come out from the bush and the road is bad, rough. Plus, we tried ourselves with my son-in-laws, my sons, and others, the villagers. There is a tractor in Napi, but it broke down. That is how we come as like donkeys. We had to pull a cart, pull in the cart with gravel, and try to the juncture where that bad spot. This is where I am telling you, Excellency, please, I want you to see us ready because we need a tractor for personally, for my family people. And they are farmers up to today. I am a farmer. We have plants, oranges, tangerine, pear, everything is there, planted and flower up now. To bring out the produce now, how must we bring it? We don't.
When the village, we give the village a tractor, right?
I know, Excellency, but we need a tractor special because this tractor always be busy. When we ask for the tractor, it's busy. It will be busy all the time. So we need a tractor specially. And there is a lot of people doing farming in my Paima area. And we always bring out our produce with bicycle. Everybody know, the villagers know, the Tusha know. It's not like. So we want a tractor really for we to work and bring out the produce to the market. And today I am still planting, I'm old, but I'm still planting. According to what I am saying, I'm a farmer right now. I plant kilo mangoes in Savannah, this in Parish Shara. There the road, 10 acres. Plus, I have more to plant again. So we are farmers. We supporting NAPI again with the farin from my Paima. So this is where I am thinking about the road. Because the road never for years, since the previous two shows passed away already. We used to sign for the roadside. Up to today, the road have been done at all. So we really wanted a tractor so that we will stop dragging the cart. We really have
okay.
to struggle.
Okay,
so,
Uncle Manchu.
Thank you, Excellent. That is my.
Okay, work. Okay, pressure. We hear you. Good.
Thank you. I just would like to remind villagers that if an issue has been raised in your village, kindly not mention it.
Good afternoon, His Excellency, all political observers. Senior Councilor Parishara, I would like to make a few requests here. I just want to support Uncle Machu. He's a resident of Parishara, but he farms way down in Maipa, which is actually within Napi people farm. Right? So, yes, the Parishara people does not farm this end, but we farm to the east of the village. And a request that I want to make now is that our farmlands, we know Parishara is at a boundary, and we are suffering in terms of the forest. We want to use the forest. So with the LCS funds, we have worked and on the bush is 6 acres of land, right? We need to understand that it was ordered by PAC. And up to now, we're still waiting. Like I said, we want to use the forest, right? But most of the farmers, like Uncle Mark said, he's farming this end, but the Parishara people want to go to the east. It's more closer for us than you see talking about tractor going down here. It's more closer down there, but with this issue with us, with the low carbon and the agreement with, I understand that, but our livelihood is in the forest. So that's one, I'm still waiting to work on PAC. Number two, Mr. President, there are contractors that do contracts in the village, and when they leave the work, maybe they use the wet wood, and then when they leave it, with all the ceilings and the back, like they make back houses. So, you know, we got to go over back, renovating, and then requesting that the villagers that are receiving contracts, the villagers should take the contract, because we get an idea how to build it so that we can be back infested when we finish with the building. Right, so Parashara is, right now, the health center is butt infested. If you look, it's a new renovated building, very well, but butt infested. And it's a health center. We're looking if we can get a complete building, do over, not to renovate it anymore, but a complete building we're looking to requesting here. And the under education, with the teachers' quarters, the primary teachers' quarters, it has been renovated, like, twice, but it's the same thing. The persons that come to do it, remember, I know the contractor want to make a raise, you know, as he's speaking, so they look to purchase the cheapest things. So when they leave, it's damaged quickly. So again, I'm requesting that villages that get in contract, I think we have people that can handle these buildings in our community. Number three, although we have the hub in Parashara, right? It's still a request for the primary school there and the health center for a Wi-Fi, so that it will be much easier for them.
Okay, so we will transfer the $2 million we have for the quarters to you in the village, so you can do it.
Thank you very much, Mr. President.
Good.
Yes, under Agri, I want to request some wires, right? We know that villages have tractors. But the little farming that we do in the village, the villagers don't have the money to purchase these wires to farm, to fence the farm. And we have cows entering and damaging the people's farm. And there's a criteria there that you're going to demand a little payment and you don't want to pay. And you know, it's a challenge to the village. So requesting for some wires that we can fence the farm or we can fence the whole farmland. Thank you very much.
All right, good morning, Mr. President and Minister of Education. And we have another minister here, regional chairman, REU, and others who are here present. I take this opportunity to thank the Mr. President for being here. I am so glad to see you for a very long time. Only on the internet we will be able to see that you are representing Guyana overseas and other places. And we are so glad that you can be able to represent Guyana as a whole, and we are thankful that you are doing your job. And as I'm a preacher, I preach for the Church of Christ, and I know that when leaders are there, they are not just like that. It is God who rises up kings and rulers cast down. And he appoint boundaries and times, and he yield not to control from on high. And so we know that God is the one who put you there. And so we are thankful that God has put you there so that you will be there to support your people and our people. Mr. President, I know that you will do some answering, but I have some things that need to clear up. I was at the Rojagrong some time ago when you made some commitments where you said the CPGs will now be paid, and also said councillors will be paid. And I was close to you and I was listening, so I just captured that. That was like two rodeos ago, and I really had it in my mind all the time. So I don't know which councillors will be paid, and maybe the town council or which council, but I just wanted that to clear up today, and CPGs, because we never collected any payment since that time. So that is one thing that I wanted to clear up from the year before we did with that. And the other thing, I have applied for a firearm, and a lot of villagers also applied for firearm, licensed firearm, but there is no, it's over close to 2 years now. The duplicate that I had,
the thermites already destroyed that because it took so long. If there is, I'm requesting that if they say no to our application, if we can't get the firearm, at least to notify us to say that your application is not approved or something, because we are waiting so long and there is no response really what is happening with our applications. There are a lot of persons here who applied still waiting on the if it is approved or not. We only have the letter of acknowledgement, but there is no response really if whether we will get it or not. So if you can please give us some thing today. So thank you so much, President, once again. Tushar mentioned something. I just want to see if I can do something a little bit on that. That is the sports. Mr. President, if I know we are asking too much, but from experience, I am the counselor for sports, and I really want to go towards that. What we experience every year is that transportation is a big issue for us. When we go to compete with other villages in our RFA league, we're having a big challenge with transportation. And if we can have a transportation for our sports club, we are so grateful for that. If there is any bus stall up there in Georgetown, they come this side to us for our club. Thank you very much.
So just to clarify, I think what you're talking about is what Minister Benwell said. But we are working on a program now with the Guyana Defense Force to see how we can collaborate different type of activities, like the Border Patrol, CPG, and the resort training that we have. So hopefully within the coming weeks, we can find a solution that will allow us, especially in border towns, in border communities, to have a different approach with CPG, right? So I'm going to work on this to see within a week or two how we can come up with a solution, all right? So that I can assure you of.
All right, we will be accepting two more persons' requests, and I would like to request that Ms. Petronella Regis to report backstage.
Pleasant good morning, Your Excellency, Honorable Minister of Education, members of the head table, villagers from the outlying communities. Good morning to you. I am Jean Ligafook, the head teacher of NAPI Primary, including a secondary top. Minister, first, I would like to show appreciation for your support towards the school and your love towards the school, as you had mentioned before. We are in receipt of past papers for the grade 11s, and we are thankful for that. Each student will be given a package of past papers so that they can work in preparation for the exam. Also, I would like to show appreciation for the construction of a new secondary school, a junior secondary school. We are so thankful that our students from these villages here will finally be able to have their own secondary school. And it should include all the facilities, science labs, home economics department, and computer labs, and so on. And another thing we are thankful for is the cash grant. The cash grants have been given to the schools, and we are trying as much as possible to see how wisely we can spend that money to make our children comfortable in the classroom. And what we have purchased during this term here are fans. The school roof is very low, and like this time here, it's heated. It's like an oven in there. And the way how it is built makes it even more hot. So we have bought fans and we have bought water dispensers. But what is lacking there in the school is the electricity. We would like to have batteries. And some more points run in the building in the secondary department. All right, so batteries most important at this time here in preparation for the new school term. Another request I have here is for laptops for the subject teachers. Presently we are really facing challenges with students and their SBAs because of the resources lacked. And I'll be grateful if the subject teachers can get laptops. We have been giving students opportunity to write 7 to 8 subjects, and we are including one more for the new academic year. So we are thankful for having the teachers who are specialized in these areas. All they need now is the training. But we are trying with the untrained teachers, and they have shown dedication towards their work. Okay, I would like to support Mr. Demetro when he mentioned the payment for the cooks, because that was one on my list of requests for the hot meals cooks, because presently their payments are taken out of the children's meals money for payments, and we would like it to be separated, separate payments for them. Honorable Minister and His Excellency the President, I have a long list and I would like to give it to you instead of me reading it out here, and I do hope that you look at the list. Thank you very much.
So right now, HM, you have 4 teachers training from the secondary program and 4 from the TVET program. So very soon, you're going to have fully trained teachers in the school. By the time the school is finished, you'll have teachers,
yes.
Trained teachers.
Yes, thank you very much.
And I want to thank you for running not only a primary school, but a very large secondary department. Thank you very much, you and your staff.
Good afternoon, His Excellency Dr. Mohamed Irfanali, the 2 ministers that are visiting NAPI today. I'm a bit unhealthy, but I just thought it wise to support whoever spoke today, and I would like to support them in whatever way that they have asked. And I hope that you, I heard that you are transferring and has the power to do a lot of things. I would just like to present our extension request, and the story is in the package. So I hope that you're going to read through and give us a feedback maybe before you join that chopper back to Lethem and then to Georgetown, please, and thank you.
All right, thank you, ladies and gentlemen. And one more request from Michelle Abraham Ali. She would like to spend one more night. And to close off proceedings, I would like to invite Ms. Petronella Regis to offer some words of appreciation to our president and his team today.
I just want to say, in addition to all the things I've responded to, that we are taking detailed notes. We will share those notes back with the region and with chairman, and we're going to work to see what we can accomplish and what we can do, okay? I can't promise you everything, but we'll see as much as we can do, and we'll communicate back to the communities what we'll be doing, okay? But for the purposes of these meetings that I had over the last 2 days, Minister Premani Chan and Minister Vikram Bharat, with the REO and the chairman, they're in charge of implementing all the commitments across all the sectors. So they're the ones who will come back and ensure we don't have to go back to the sector. They will look at all the commitments across all the sectors, okay?
Just one thing I want to say. I know I'm breaking protocol, but Minister of Education, I present education. about the design of the school. Don't you think it's time that a body of people sit and revisit the design of the school, considering the climate conditions that we have now? Because it's always been hot at a certain time in the day. And a new school is built, the same design, the same suffering for the teachers and the children. So I was wondering if you cannot...
The design is a new design. It's a two flats.
No, you're talking about the new school.
The new school, yeah.
No, we still have the primary school at... They go through the same thing. So if the benefit is going to be in school, let the engineer or whoever designs it relook the design and see if they can modify it to think about climate change. Okay. Thank you, and sorry to disrupt your program.
His Excellency President Irfan Ali, Minister of Education, Ms. Priya Manickton, Minister of Natural Resources, Mr. Vikram Barry, and the rest of the visiting team, a pleasant good afternoon to each and every one of you. On behalf of the residents of Napi, Parashara, Haiwa, Kaikombe, Yupukari, Fly Hill, and the other communities, I'm here too. I'm being asked to do a big favor. That is to thank you for making this visit. And as I stand before you this afternoon, I can remember years ago that I had asked personally at one of the meetings that you return after you win the elections. So here you are. Thank you for visiting. I would like to thank the Minister of Education at this time for, I've heard all the thank yous, and another thank you to you for considering our secondary needs, especially secondary needs. There was once a villager in Napi, many, many years ago, who had a dream, and we all had that dream. And that dream is coming through. And it was no other than the late Mr. George Tancredo, who everyone knows around the world. And his dream was that a secondary school be established in Napi. And that was his dream, and it's finally coming through. And let's give that man a round of applause for having that dream. And not forgetting, it was our dream also as villagers. So thank you very much. And I do hope that I would like to also add to what the present HM is saying, that, you know, it comes with everything. But my concern this afternoon, Minister, is that I know that when a secondary school is attached to a primary school, they are entitled to a hot meal. My concern is, seeing that they will be separated, what becomes of that? I want you to think about that.
We don't take away benefit. That was the last government. They took away the children money. So whatever benefit children have, we add to it. We never take away benefit.
Okay, but that is coming. That is one of the rules by the school feeding program.
No. There's no. Yeah. Oh, Minister has just confirmed to that all the secondary children will be getting also and are getting. No.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Okay.
Yes. Okay. May I continue?
With your vote of thanks.
Yes. Okay. I forgot that. Sorry. I was a little, you know, trying to make the minister know what my concern was at the same time. All right. So to everybody visiting here today, ministers, I see my education department rep there. And I know that she took all the notes and so on. Thank you to all of you for making this visit. I know you want to go to the rodeo, but just spend a little bit of time with us. We are thankful for all that you have done. All the thank yous were done before me, but I don't think any mention was made about that doctor's building over there. Thank you for that building. It's not occupied as yet. We don't know who is going to go there. We have a doctor from the community who is still working in Lytton. So we do hope that very soon somebody will occupy that building, because we really need a resident doctor in this community to serve the neighboring communities. We would like to also thank you
for... Dr. Dimitro will be here full time very soon. The transition is taking place at the moment.
Thank you very much. Give that. Thank you, everybody. Yes, we all know that. We have the health team right here from NAPI. All right? So we don't have to go and search very far for those people. Dr. Ali, we would like to thank you very much for coming here. And if I have not mentioned you, everybody, Yupikari people, Kaikombe, all those who are present here this afternoon, please, we thank you for coming. And all those who made it possible for having the president here, we would like to thank you. To the pilots, to the drivers, to the security, to everybody who put an effort into, and those, not forgetting those who did the preparations for everything to make this event a success. Please feel that, you know, your hard work, your dedication towards serving your country is appreciated. I would like to ask everyone to stand at this time. Everyone. Oh, sorry, not you. Okay, let's give the president and his visiting team cheers, all right? So when I say hip hip hip, you must say hooray for the rodeo people to hear us. Then if you're not so loud, I will say it again. And then for their families to hear it in Georgetown, all right? Good, so are we ready? I forgot you, Michelle, I'm sorry, all right. Good, so let's begin. Hip, hip, hip.
Hooray!
Come on, that's not loud. Hip, hip, hip.
Hooray!
Georgetown cannot hear that. One more time. Hip, hip, hip.
Hooray!
Okay, thank you very much, everybody. Have an enjoyable day.
Thank you.